Hello everyone, and welcome to the Long Lost Part 3 video of a short series I posted here on YouTube over 2 years ago titled The Wallace to Burke Mile Marker Tour. In these videos, we took a trip up Canyon Creek Road, also known as State Highway 4, and visited the various town, mine, and mill sites that once were located along the 7-mile stretch of road between Wallace and Burke, Idaho. Each one of these places contributed to making Coeur d'Alene Mining District, also known as the Silver Valley, the largest producer of silver in the world. In this final video, your vehicle's odometer is not really needed. Burke sits in a location in the canyon that's only about 300 feet across and about 3/4 of a mile long. Most of the places I point out are easy enough to spot, though they're not always recognizable. The entire tour starts at the intersection of Bank and 6th Street in downtown Wallace, and the second video ended after visiting the mine and town site of Mesa, Idaho. This last video will look at the old mining town of Burke and the various mines and mills that made it one of the more important sites in the Coeur d'Alene Mining District. At mile 6.4 on the right is the historic marker sign that lets you know that you're entering the town of Burke. Burke is unique and has the distinction of having been the subject of two Ripley's Believe It or Not newspaper columns, due mostly because of the Tiger Hotel, and I have more to share on that location later. As you can see, Burke is not 100% ghost. There are still about a dozen or so people who live here and call this home. There are no longer any stores or services here, but being only about 7 miles from Wallace, it's close enough that a few folks still live here throughout the year and are not completely isolated. As was the case with most of the other towns in the Silver Valley, Burke's beginning was back in 1884 during the height of the Coeur d'Alene Gold Rush that was happening along the North Fork of the Coeur d'Alene River and its tributaries about 20 miles to the north. Gold prospectors had fanned out from the North Fork area in search of new locations. Traveling along a small trail that connected the gold town of Raven with the old Mullen Military Wagon Road along the South Fork, two prospectors happened upon a large outcropping of galena and quartz that was exposed along the north hillside. This was the birth of the Tiger Mine. Just a few weeks after that, another galena discovery was made on the south side, directly across from where the Tiger was located, and that became the Poor Man Mine. These discoveries were the beginning of the camp that would shortly become the town of Burke. An interesting side note to this is that galena was not really the first discovery made here. Just a year earlier, Andrew J. Pritchard, the man credited with the first gold discovery in the North Fork area around what would become Eagle and Pritchard Creeks, had panned gold from the mouth of Gorge Gulch where it intersects Canyon Creek. Early in 1883, Pritchard, along with some fellow prospectors, returned to this area and struck claims in what would become the town of Burke and on the other side of the hill, which would later be called 9 Mile Canyon. One of the men who was with Pritchard at that time was Colonel W.R. Wallace, the founder of the miners' camp that would one day become the town of Wallace. It was just 1 month later that two prospectors, John Carton and Almeda Seymour, made their discoveries that became the Tiger Mine. For the next couple of years, Burke remained a fairly small camp. In 1886, Burke only had 3 stores and a handful of residents. But things were about to change that would cause this camp of small log cabins and tents to become a true silver boom town. The Tiger Mine was shipping their raw ore into Montana unconcentrated. In 1887, the Tiger began construction on a concentrator that was able to process more than 25 tons of ore per day. Also, the railroad was laying down rail and making their way towards Burke. First in was the Northern Pacific, and they were soon joined a short time later with the arrival of the Oregon Rail and Navigation Company, and that later became the rails of the Union Pacific. By 1888, the population of Burke grew to over 800 people. There were two working mines, the Tiger and the Poor Man, a concentrator, and railroad service. The town now had over 300 buildings that included four general stores, two boarding houses, a beer hall, fruit stand, two hardware stores, a bakery, livery stable, doctors, lawyers, and of course, 17 saloons. And all these buildings, houses, and mine works had to share space in a 300-foot-wide, steep, narrow canyon. Large numbers of people and businesses crowded that close together presented challenges that other mining towns didn't face. With only one main road and two railroad lines sharing the same space, getting from one place to another presented a challenge. It's been said that the local store owners had to go outside and raise their store awnings at certain times of the day so the trains could pass and not tear them off. Families with infant children even adapted the wheels of their baby carriages to fit the rails. Many years later, when automobiles became common, car owners even left their keys in the ignition so that if needed, the engineer could get out and move their car and make room for the train. As with any other town in North Idaho, Burke had to contend with Mother Nature. Heavy snows in the winter, rains in spring and fall were just a fact of life here. Deadly avalanches happened up and down the canyon almost every year, destroying homes, businesses, and lives. Tailings and garbage in the river contributed to the creek overrunning its banks during heavy rains and runoff. Entire buildings were swept away by floods. And of course, the thing people feared most in these towns was fire. Being so tightly packed together and the buildings being constructed of wood, the constant threat of fire was always present. One of the worst happened in 1923, when a fire started further down the canyon and burned its way into Burke. Mines, mills, houses, and businesses were burnt to the ground. Three quarters of the town of Burke lay in smoldering ruins before the fire was extinguished. The entire business section, along with the surface workings of Hecla, were gone. But Burke rebuilt, just as countless other mining towns had done in the past. The town continued to prosper. By 1910, the population grew to over 1,500 people. Two world wars brought about greater needs for lead and zinc. And during the war years, Burke and the Coeur d'Alene Mining District, along with Pitcher, Oklahoma and the Tri-State District, were considered so vital to the United States war effort that the government subsidized the mining to keep them open and running at full capacity. While other mines and districts were closed and their workers sent to fight overseas, the U.S. government was paying to keep these mines open and continuously expanding. The miners even got to choose how to best serve their country. They could either wear a steel army helmet and carry a rifle, or they could wear a miner's hat and carry a pick. But by the end of World War II, life had changed. Not only had the need for certain metals diminished, but the social and community needs of our nation were changing. Mineral discoveries were no longer being made as they once had in the past. In fact, the mines now were starting to close. Many had closed over the years due to the ore being depleted. Some of the mines in the Burke area had been running at full capacity for so many years that it was just inevitable that they would one day be out of ore. By April of 1954, Burke only had one service station, one grocery store, and three bars. The rest had all been closed down. Burke was becoming abandoned, and there was nothing that was going to keep it from disappearing completely. The last nail in Burke's coffin came in 1981 when the Star Mine closed. Since then, there have been brief moments of very light activity at the Hecla Star. Burke has long ceased to be, even remotely, what it once was. In 2012, Hecla invested about $7 million to do some basic rehabilitation at the Hecla Star in hopes of bringing out some of the zinc that was still accessible on certain levels. They also did exploration to see what might still be available in workable areas. They concluded that there were still over 25 million ounces of silver that could be taken out of the old Hecla Star workings. But just as those reports were coming in, silver prices once again declined sharply. Even knowing there's still so much silver, lead, and zinc available here in Burke, the cost involved in bringing these abandoned works back to life and meeting the current codes and standards make mining here again very unlikely.